move to our next speaker, which is Edwin Nuiten from Nationale Nederlanden. We are really proud to have him here. He's going to tell about his company. He's going to tell about his role and about his department and how they have evolved from, let's say, document management type to really customer engagement type department, which is, I think, very relevant to a lot of listeners here. So give a big hand, virtually, of course, to Edwin Nuiten. Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick. Good morning, everybody. I hope everybody is healthy at this moment in this special time during the COVID virus. I'm here on the location in Utrecht, and I like to give you a short overview of our transition towards a more customer-centric organization of the NN Group, and especially the journey of Content and Communication Service, which is my own department. And we started the journey from integration, we are still working on the last things, towards more customer engagement. So it's an honor to talk about that transition and that journey of us. Small agenda for today. The agenda, first a personal introduction, the NN company profile, our ambition to become a best-in-class customer-centric organization, how we are we organized to achieve eventually our ambition, some more specific information about content and communication services, what's our ambitions and what are our services for NN Group. And we will zoom in the objectives of efficiency and cost reduction. And last but not least, the objective of customer engagement with a short overview of the interactive video from Aflossingsvrij, Aflossingsblij. I'm alone here today. Originally, Edgar would join me. He's one of my product owners in my team, but unfortunately, he couldn't be here today. So I will do. I will elaborate on this journey, and I will keep Edgar informed about all the movements we make today. Oh yeah, one last thing. I'm working for NN since 2005, and since June 2019, I joined this department, so Content and Communication Service, as a manager of that department. Later on, there will be more information about my department. Who we are, a company profile. Now, here you see an overview. NN Group is an international financial service company, active in 80 countries, with a strong presence in a number of European countries and Japan. We create all kinds of products, retirement services, pensions, insurances, investments, and banking. And we have got approximately 80 million customers, so that's a lot. We have got also a lot of brands, such as Nationale Nederlanden, NN for the international markets, and investment partners, ABN AMRO Assurance, Movi, Azatel, BeFrank, Aura, and last but not least, during this year, we also got Vivat Schadis, we also part later on of the non-life department. And NN Group is listed on the Euronext Amsterdam. What we do, our strategic framework. During the Capital Markets Day in June, we introduced our new or refined strategy and our strategic framework. And the strategic framework is visualizes the strategic direction of the NN Group, so including all its business units. It's led by our business and ambition, and guided by our values and brand promises, and driven by our strategic commitments, which you see on the right side. So it's about customer and distribution, products and services, people and organization, financial strength and society. Now I want to show you a picture or a movie about our purposes. So can we start that one?
The world in which we live may change, but what truly matters to people remains the same. What matters to them matters to us.
Fraude.
Door.
De klimaatverandering aanpakken.
Out of me.
Use our talent to do good.
Wat voor mij heel belangrijk is, is nieuwsgierigheid.
Als Amber, ik heb zo dat ook.
Hayat, ben je zo.
At NN, we care for the well-being of our customers and our communities. We care for our planet. And we care for a stable, inclusive, and sustainable economy. We continue to contribute to a world in which people can thrive for many generations to come. People care for what matters most to them.
So that was a story about our purpose. So very personal, relevant and digital. So keep that in mind during the next slides. A short recap of our legacy. So we have been there for 175 years. And I want to zoom in, particularly the last 4 years, so 4 or 5 years. 2013, we launched the NN brand and a logo. Then after that, in 2014, NN Group was listed at the Euronext Amsterdam. And we did an acquisition of Deltaloid and did the integration with the Dutch and Belgian activities of NN. And the last one, which you see here in the picture, is the acquisition of Vivat Non-Life. So a lot of history, and we are building our company and do a lot of acquisition at this moment. Our structure, this is the whole company. We are working in the CIO, this is a central IT organization within the NN group. And when you zoom in that particular structure, we are working for the enterprise technology services, which are generic services for all the business units. And we are then the department content and communication services. So all the client communication, besides, excluding the app and the portal, are within our department. Now let's have a few moments for our ambition and to zoom in the customer engagement or the customer-centric organization, which I said earlier during the Capital Markets Day. All business units have presented their plans upwards from 2021 to 2025, including all the investment they have to do. To be best-in-class, customer-centric insurer. We also looked at some market trends. So we see a shift of customer demand towards digitalization and self-service solutions. We see a market appetite switch from product push to broad cross-organization solutions and renewed approach towards customers. So we have taken this into account and did an analysis and we have looked at the indicated market trends, which is confirmed also by market research. And based on this analysis, NN has identified several areas, which you see in the middle. So you see the NPS, the Net Promoter Score, the level of digitalization, and the brand awareness. And specifically for our department, the level of digitalization and also the self-service is an important one. So coming from these areas, we also introduced three categories or teams, so self-service, joint propositions, and brand. And the above one is the most important for us. So we have translated our strategy into ambitions, teams, and in combination with our strategic commitments. Now, CCS, so content and communication services. Yeah, we as CCS provide generic application services with information within the information technology domain. Our ambition, you see it here, we want to become a trusted advisor and facilitator for the NN Group business to become a customer-centric and digital company by providing centralized and personalized content, communication, and distribution services, which are, of course, stable and available and using modern technologies. My department is split into three domains. You see the team multi-channel services, which, for example, does the direct mailing service, the personalized interactive video. We've got team print and mail, which does requested mailings, the outbound framework development, etc. And we've got the scanning and archiving part, so it's delivering inbound and archiving services. And it's approximately around 80-85 people working here in these three domains. So we are also focusing from simplification integration towards customer engagement and customer interaction. On this screen, you see the summary of it. So we, on the left side, you see the strategic commitments of the NN Group. And we have translated it in our objectives. So the first one is customer engagement. The second one, efficiency and reducing costs and scaling our services. Because we, with scaling, we can eventually reduce our cost and be more efficient for our business units. The next step I want to do is to show you the objective efficiency and cost reduction. And the last years, starting from 2017, we have worked a lot for the integration of the Deltaloid department. So we started in 2017 with the acquisition, and eventually we now decommed or replatformed more than 800 applications. So for my department, it were around 40 applications we integrated. And what did we do on the content part or the on the outbound part? We branded all the communication. So that was an enormous task for us. And we eventually integrated the Deltaloid system in our landscape, so in the NN landscape. So that was also an important step we have made together with our suppliers. The second objective is customer engagement. So to get the basic in order, the next step is from simplification towards customer engagement. So by providing a generic, centralized platform that maximizes ease of use by providing branding and reusable components. And what we see, what is customer engagement for us, it's about customer perceptions that are influenced by all the touch points. So it doesn't matter where the customer is, on the portal, in the app, or on the internet, or does he need some physical communication. It's all supported by us. So not limited to a particular type of medium or product. So a central orchestration and cooperation is key in this. What we do on this subject, we enable our business to reach their engagement goals. So providing a generic platform, so an outbound platform, an archiving platform, where they can focus on the messages. Synergy by centralization, and the maximizing of use, ease of use, efficiency by providing branding and reusable components as part of the framework. So the business units care about their content, and we, and our mission is your content, our care. So they don't have to care about these subjects. We will manage that for them. Solution when we're talking about customer engagement is interactive video. It was also mentioned earlier in some talks, and I want to show you some things about that. So customer engagement example is the interactive video. Why we started that? We must provide our customers, so from an NN Bank perspective, we must provide our customers with insight into their interest-only mortgage. We will also have to inform them and support customers to our intermediary channel through them, And we have made our communication personal and used interactive buttons to send them directly to the information desired at that time. So that was an objective from the NN Bank mortgages department. What were the results? By personal and relevant, by being personal and relevant to the need of desired information, this campaign runs for at least 1 year and can be called up at any time. The required action must be administered so we can comply with our information obligation. And also the conversion of viewers has turned out to be many times higher than by email. So that's a very positive movement with the interactive video. And on the right side, you see some views of the interactive video. And we can also share some components of the interactive video right now. So can we start that one, please? This is one of the examples. It's the starting point of for our customers. And then they can do an interactive clicking in the screen. So we can show that also. So that's the next step. Can we show that next one? So choose one of the opportunities.
Klanten actief benaderen om de scan te doorlopen. We beginnen met de groep klanten bij wie het risico hoog lijkt te zijn. Via e-mail nodigen wij de klant uit om de hypotheekscan in te vullen. Dit kunnen ze zelf doen of samen met jou. Binnen 5 minuten heb jij samen met de klant inzichtelijk gemaakt hoe het ervoor staat met de wendbaarheid en betaalbaarheid van zijn hypotheek, nu en in de toekomst.
Klanten kunnen een persoonlijke rapportage downloaden. Die is gebaseerd op de ingevulde gegevens. De rapportage bevat tips hoe de eventuele risico's verkleind kunnen worden. Hierbij raadt Nationale Nederlanden de klant aan om met zijn financieel adviseur, jij dus, te bespreken welke mogelijkheden het best passen in zijn situatie.
Yeah, I think this was a good example of customer engagement and the interactive video we've made, where it's possible to have a clickable site and get the client to the important information he wants to get. A wrap up. So we started this journey today with our purpose and our ambition, and also zooming in okay, we want to have the ambition to become a best-in-class customer-centric organization, known by its customer engagement. That's very important. So not only simplification and integration of a lot of things, but also having attention for customer engagement. How we've translated this? We've translated this also for our department, so translated it into customer engagement, efficiency, cost reduction, and scaling. One of the objectives was also mentioned. It's about the Deltaloid integration, what was very successful. And we've done a lot of rebranding and decommissioning. For the next steps, we want to zoom in the customer engagement subject by, for example, the interactive video. And we want to focus for the future even more on this subject to be customer-centric, so to increase the customer-centric part. By, for example, e-signing, QR codes, generic notifications, etc., etc. So a lot of things to do, and a very nice journey to go ahead. So thank you for your attention, and maybe see you in the future. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Edwin. That, I think, was a really great and compelling story, and for a lot of our viewers, it'll undoubtedly be inspiring to see how a really big company like you handles this. Could you maybe elaborate a little bit? You talked about the future, but what do you expect from, let's say, vendors like us or others in collaborating with you? What's the most important thing you look for? Is it is it innovation? Is it relationship? Is it agility? Or can you tell a bit more about that?
Yeah, of course. And we've very much focused on integration. So simplification of our landscape. I think that's an important one.
Yeah.
Very important, especially when you look at efficiency and the cost reduction. But I think we need partnerships in getting towards the next step of customer engagement. So that's so knowledge. We talk to Aspire, for example, which can help companies making the next step. So I think that's an important one. But also experience with getting to a new platform of customer interaction. So and that's important. For our suppliers to give us that information. Yeah,
I can imagine. So it's good to see that your company really recognizes the added value and how important it is to go about customer engagement. Does that help you when you, for example, present a business case to implement something that helps that experience? Does that make your life easier?
Yes, of course. I've said, okay, we have done a lot of simplification, but now we have started a roundtable discussion with all our business units, for example, life, non-life, banking, and they want to move towards the customer engagement. So we have to do this together. That's very important because we have a big company. And before you know it, one business unit introduces an innovation on customer engagement, but the other ones don't know it. So I think we are the driver we deliver that generic services so that all business units can increase their customer engagement eventually.
Yeah, and I think what's good is that you then are open, as we know what you did with the personalized interactive video, to even though you're centralized and have to support a really big company, that you're still open to innovation. That's what I found compelling about this story. So that's maybe not a question, but a compliment to
thank you
to your department. Philippe, I heard there was some questions from the audience, mate.
Yes, there are a couple. So Edwin, first of all, compliments for your story, very clear.
Thank you.
Do you have any insights you could share around certain conversion rates or how the people are experiencing the video? Do you see a difference there compared to other channels?
Using the
video itself, the interactivity.
We saw in the presentation also an increase in reactions of our customers, so that's a positive one. I don't know the numbers by head, but because someone of the marketing and product management department knows it.
Yeah, probably.
But there was an increase, that's for sure.
Yeah. And any demographic data? Like, is there a difference in viewing rate by age group? I'm not sure if you're measuring that.
I don't know.
But maybe we could... I don't know if that...
Yeah, we can send that information afterwards, for example, if it's a need. So we can do that. It should be available.
Yeah. And there's also a question in how did Dialog Group supported you in this process?
We've done the rebranding. We have set all the things from Deltaloid outbound to NN outbound. So all the communication, the NN logo and the NN touch and feel is on the communication. We did it together. And also during the replatforming and decommissioning of the Engage platform, the Dialog Group helped us very good during that journey.
Good to hear.
Yeah.
Luckily. Also, another question of Dennis. He's asking, this is for reaching out to agents, an indirect channel. Is it also used for NN customers?
Not yet.
Okay.
We have introduced it with this aflossingsvrij, aflossingsblij campaign. This is the first pilot we did. But now, based on also the roundtable discussion with the business units, we want to introduce it even more and make it even more personal. Because this is, we can make it more personalized than we have seen in the presentation. So that's the next step we want to make. Yeah.
Looking forward to it. Yeah. These were the questions.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. So maybe one more thought, because what I find really interesting is I see a central thread with the stuff that that Caspar has said, that you've said, and that we experienced with Star SHL as well, recognizing the importance of the customer experience, but also being aware that you need to start small, experiment, and not be afraid to then enlarge in it. At what stage? Because if you need to do a quick experiment, you can grab anything off the internet. But do you also look in that innovation stage, if that Lego block that you use, for example, with the interactive video, it could be chat, it could be emailed, could be anything. Do you already look at, let's say, stuff like security, scalability, platform fit, contracting, before you experiment, or is that something?
In my opinion, it should be very small, and then in parallel we think about platforming, security, etc. But it should be there when we do the introduction. So that's. It's one thing you can't go behind.
I understand.
But in a bigger company, there are all sort of kind of procedures we have to mention and we have to take care of. But that doesn't have to stop us by introducing a new innovation and experimenting. So that should be my answer.
What I always say is we're not a huge company, but we're dealing with huge companies. So that besides agility, it's easy for us. We're small and it's in our mindset. But having to deal with all the compliancy and stuff, it really takes a lot of expertise to go there. Yeah. And luckily, by staying in the branches that we are, we recognize a lot of the problems and the let's say the guidelines you guys have to be able to do business.
But I think it starts with mindset.
Yeah,
that's an important one. And from there we will manage it. That's my opinion. But
a pragmatic. We call it easy, personal, pragmatic. Doing that. Yeah. Well, that might be a good moment to if there are no more questions in the chat. To just have a seat at the table, ask Caspar to join in as well.
Yep.
And we've got some topics we would like to just have an organic discussion around.
Yep.
So grab a seat. Caspar, welcome back. We've got three topics lined up that we can have an organic discussion, like I said. But audience, this is an interactive platform, so please join in by posing more statements or coming up with your own opinion, okay? So I'll have a look.
Yep.
We do a quick COVID type switch because I'm not allowed to sit in your chair, Edwin. Sorry. So we've got some dialogue going on. For the people who joined us later, let's go clockwise. We just saw at Unite from Nationale Nederlander. We've got our own dialogue group colleague, Philippe, responsible for business development and innovation. And we've got Caspar Roos from analyst firm Aspire lined up here. I will just be your humble host and refrain from opinion. At least I will try to. So having that out of the way, we've got some nice discussion lined up, and maybe we'll start just clockwise, and then the other ones I'll do otherwise. So, in this COVID period, do you consider, Edwin, a digital customer experience as the new normal? What's your statement?
My first reaction would be yes, but we also see a lot of physical communication at this time. So it's decreased because of the COVID virus, but we are not there. That is fully digital. So that's the next step we want to make. But I think it should be the new normal.
So it's a big yes. But
we aren't there yet.
And is that because of technical constraints, procedural constraints, data constraints, systems constraints, organizational constraints? Where do you see that?
My first reaction would be it's also a mindset of our customers, but also of our own company in being more digital. So I think it should be a one-stop shop. It doesn't matter what kind of communication the customer wants. It should be tailored for each customer. So and then the digital experience is an important one, I think.
Yeah, we always like to say that companies focus on the NPS, right? We often say, please also look at customer effort score. How easy is it for a customer to do business with you? And I remember talking to somebody from a very big insurance firm as well, multi-country, that said, you know what, and I spoke about that in my intro, in the marketing phase, we send you all these beautiful mobile responsive emails, and you can use our chatbot to get more information on the products. And once you become a customer, we bury you. We just literally bury you in paper with all the statements and the policies and the wet signatures even that people need to put on that. So there's a lot to gain.
Yeah, that was one example for e-signing. Why do people have to sign them and put them in the scan? And then get it within the organization, for example, for live or non-live. So why shouldn't it be digital?
Yeah. Okay. Philippe, you had some more time to think. So next time I'll cut Edwin some slack. But
I would reframe this like customer experience is normal. It shouldn't be the new normal, right? So I think as a company, everybody is investing in that. And I think digital is everywhere. Even if I go to a shop, if you look at it from that purpose, people are using technology to serve the customer. So digital customer experience is normal, I would say. It's not the new normal, but it is just accelerating by the way of working we are now doing, and everybody is using their own devices from home. If you would say a couple of months ago, I remember discussions with our customers like, your consultants need to be here in the office because otherwise we don't see what's going on. And now everybody is remotely. And that's accelerated by digital. So why not in the customer experience? I think the bar is even raised now because people are rapidly adopting technology. And I think it will have a serious impact on your customer experience. Positive, I believe, if you do it well. But waiting is not an option, I think.
I can understand that. So if I would summarize that, you want it to be the new normal, but we are not there yet.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we would be already out of business. But
yeah, I think we live in not normal times, but that digital is normal because of. It's a pressure cooker. It was always there. And this is, for me, typically the exponential growth you saw with COVID. I think we see it likewise with digital, and that people are able to transform very fast now in these times by digital. Even look at our event. Whoever thought that this would be our normal today.
Yeah, by the way, talking to all of you at home, I would much prefer to see you all live. A lot of people, customers we know from Belgium, by the way, je vous souhaite bienvenue aussi. It's great to meet you in person. So we don't see it going back to a fully digital society, but we can do a lot with digital self-service, right? That's a different
blended
different thing.
Purpose in your life, digital as a purposeful meaning in your life.
Yeah. Because we still like people, right?
Yes.
And how you make it personal and relevant, because sometimes digital isn't personal and relevant enough, and then you need some other things to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good one, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now we go to the heavyweight in the discussion. Yes. It's Mr. The analyst himself. So the bar is high.
Yes, the key
exactly, but I mean, there's a lot of good stuff shared here. So for me, I think it's the new normal now. And we already saw a lot of digital transformation happening. The shift to more customer experience, the shift that IT is becoming more supportive to the business, what Edwin was talking about. All those trends, to my mind, have already been visible, but it's almost, Philip, the pressure cooker, it's sort of that COVID thing really sort of accelerated this to a point where suddenly, like working from home is a really good example. So we looked at some data there. For the last 10 years, the amount of people working from home who were employed was between sort of, it started 10 years ago, about sort of 3%, and in 2019 was about 5%. So, not like 5% year-over-year growth. And then COVID happened, and then everyone who could work from home is working from home, and suddenly it jumped to about sort of 40-50%, depending on the economy and the country. And now we're talking about businesses saying, well, we'll keep those sort of hybrid models. We're not going to have, you know, our employees move back to the office 100%. In the future, it will be, people will work from home a couple of days. And that thing is, I don't see how that will be back to complete normal. And we've seen large businesses making those decisions, also driven by cost things, but it's so a lot of those trends, and also with digital from a consumer perspective, we've seen some consumers doing digital things for the first time, having sort of web meetings with a mortgage advisor.
Yeah.
Those things were not normal for a lot of consumers. For us in the business, we do a lot of those things, but for most people, this is a new experience. Is that going to change? If people are getting used to that, banking, in my mind, will fundamentally change over the next 10 years. There will be shutting down branches. They will move to that sort of more collaborative online collaboration or working. It's going to be fundamentally different, and it will happen very fast.
Yeah, I can imagine. And for the sake of interactivity, we've got some questions from the audience. I think Marcus Engel says, I agree with the mindset idea from Edwin. Do you try to change the mindset of your customers or the expectations of your customers in the sense that you try to maybe push them towards digital or?
I think one thing that was mentioned is that because of the COVID virus, people have to go more digital. So that's also an important one. And with that, I think they're starting another mindset to be more digital. So I think that should be my answer. Furthermore, yeah, we are trying to for example to get all our customers on the MijnNN environment. So this is also an important one. So we make them digital, and because of that, they can use the portal, etc., etc. So that's the first step in getting them digital, besides the COVID virus, etc. But we are working on that.
Maybe a good one, and elaborating on this one, is that Olivier Matelaert says, how do we include emotion in the digital era, especially in COVID times? And do you have any inspiration on this? Which is, I was just clamoring for human contact, right? Talking about how digital should be fun as well, which is more or less also a very positive emotion, let's say. How do you guys see that?
Yeah, so for me, emotion is paramount. So we, when we work with businesses, particularly large enterprises, we often see that they say we just want to have more automation in the customer engagement, but we don't want to make it very robotic. It needs to keep the human element, the human touch. And I think over time we'll probably see a little bit more AI there and speech recognition and those type of sort of developments. But also creativity is very important, and customer or employee engagement. So giving the people in the business the right tools to engage with customers and to have the authority to make certain decisions that would make the customer's life easier. Yeah. I think it's absolutely critical to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I agree with Casper. It's about being, as a company, not being a company anymore, but more a partner for your customer. Understanding, also what you mentioned, Edwin, understanding the data you have and adding purpose to that data for your customer in a personal touch. So I think there is also a big shift who's now in these digital worlds really in touch with the customer. Probably the people on the call center first, because they're the only path. If it's digital or by phone or whatever means, it's your workforce that's so crucial now in these challenging times to keep your customers connected and add value and purpose to your customers. I think that's really important. And people feel, you don't need to exaggerate or something, but just be natural, I think. Be there, because you're also human. If you put the shoes on of your customer, you probably understand a lot what they're trying to tell you.
Yep.
Do you listen? Or did you saw something pass?
One extra thing, I think, we are an IT department, so very inside, not outside in, but from an inside part. But now we have started to look at also the strategies of our business units to look at the purpose of our clients or the things they want to have in their digital experience. So this is also an important mindset for our IT department. The first step is knowing your internal client, and then we can get to the external client. So this is, for my department, this is a first step ahead.
It was also in your video where people set certain purposes that has nothing to do with the bank or an insurance company, but people like that because they want to give something back to society. So it's not always about the product, I think I'm saying. It's being about really purposeful a partner
and what's
in the life.
What kind of service you deliver. Huh?
Yeah.
But I also, and I maybe that's, of course, with stuff like video, you can already express much more emotions, make it more interactive, personal. That's what we discussed. And I think that's talking from a more technological and how you utilize the technology standpoint of view. But I also saw in your presentation, the amount of people that still prefer to pick up the phone across all those generations, as well as the case you presented about Star Asset Shell with the live takeover, where people still, so I believe I read somewhere, 85% will go to digital of all, let's say, business contact to digital self-service. But would that remaining 15%, right, that becomes maybe even more important, that the humans that you do encounter also can be personalized and relevant and offer quality service.
It's extremely important to know your customer, what they need, what is their need, and not one fits all.
Fully agree, and you need to look at your customer life cycle. Where are they in that life cycle? What is it that they need at a particular moment in time, and are you able to pick the right channel? Which is an interesting discussion as well. It was funny, before COVID, we really saw actually an increase in direct mail. And this is one of those things where you think about, oh, print is in decline, we're seeing it really sort of shifting more to digital, but it depends on the application. So contracts, -30% print reduction, plus everything there shifts to digital, because contracts now, it's a digital process, and we've got digital signatures, and it's a very sort of streamlined, and it makes sense to do that in that way. But if you think about sort of that customers from an empathic perspective, an emotional perspective, they respond to a physical piece of paper. That is still the case. But you don't want to sort of send them to the wrong people. So you just want to make sure that you've got the data in place. And we find a very strong correlation between data maturity, so organizations that know their customers, have a good understanding, and using the right channel, including print, direct mail. Yeah. So it's really interesting. And they can cut through the clutter, as they call it, no email spam filters and all that stuff. But then in other use cases, you just want to make sure that you have a direct, you know, interaction. Yeah. So fully agree with your point there. Just knowing your customer, know when to communicate at what point and in what channel.
Yeah. What's really nice is that in the meantime, there's a complete discussion going on in the chat, which is fine. And I have sort of eased you into the next into the next one. We've already discussed about this a little bit, which says digital service with a human touch. Why is it so important? And I think that's maybe a bit different discussion, where Olivier also says, let me look it up, there needs to be a tone of voice, element of language, and a good dosis, and here we go, of psychology and human values deeply nested into the organization. This is not about technology alone. So maybe we could...
Can I respond to that?
Yeah, of
course. Because I saw an interesting study, and I never looked at it that way, and it was a really inspiring story by a university in Belgium. And they did a research like, okay, because the elderly people can't receive any visits anymore, so they compared window, saying hi to the window with your family, compared to an iPad in the room. And then the elderly people liked the iPad in the room more because it was a closer connection. But the other insight I had there was, hey, that would be nice if, looking from a marketing department, we all do it from technology, IT, marketing, but how nice would it be to have somebody in your team who studies human science to get more out of emotional, not looking at only marketing numbers or IT numbers or whatever, but about emotion. And that could help your digital self-service to the next level, because at the end, our device is personal, it's clean, probably, not always, and that can help your business. So digital service with a human touch, with the help of also people that have studied human science in your team, that could be very interesting to see what will happen then.
Yeah, and there's, I fully agree, there's a whole lot of research being done. It's we call it information design. How do you design complex information in a way that people can understand? And it's using, you know, cognitive behavior. How do people sort of track things? I remember seeing a document once from one of my providers at the time when I still lived in England. And I was sort of reading through it, and I just then took a look back, and then I realized this is weird, because a lot of sort of content that I was expecting to sort of flow naturally, they put in different places. And I made a click later, because I was talking to someone in the business, in one of the service providers, and they said, well, we have found out that because of digital, people, if they scroll through a website, they just skim the headlines. They don't read all the text. They just jump down. So when we design documents in today's world, we need to redesign certain elements, and we need to put them. And we can use eye trackers to sort of do focus group sessions, and we can see that people jump between different places, and we need to create content that flows that in the same way. It was really interesting.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of research that's being done to sort of optimize that. And it makes sense if you create communications for millions of people, because the larger the groups, the more this stuff makes sense.
Well, that's a good bridge, because you just said, you know what, we are an IT organization, and we're used to thinking inside out, but you also touched on we have to look outside in as well, right? Yeah. So let's say customer-centric design of the communications. Can you tell a bit more about that?
Yeah, we are using customer journeys, for example. So what does a specific customer need in his life event? But I think an important one is also we are sitting on a lot of data, and then this is what you call machine learning, artificial intelligence. So that's also, and with that data, we can make that human touch, I think. Yeah? So, and make it personal, because digital self-serve, one fits all, I think it doesn't, in Dutch, het gaat niet vliegen.
It doesn't fly.
Doesn't fly.
You can use that. Yeah.
But it should be personal, and we can make it personal with the data, which is all around us.
I see a nice little touch around this, that in the new normal, that multi-language contact is a need. I know that, because in our booth you can visit a demo. To let's say an insurance onboarding, a car insurance onboarding, and you can also, if you damage, you can do reporting within a chatbot, blah blah blah. Making that multi-language from the start was not easy, and I know that, for example, doing chatbots, all these AI and NLP models, they work perfectly in English, but once you go to another language, it becomes a lot more difficult. Yeah. So what do you think about, you work in 18 countries, you work in a lot of countries. What do you think about that topic? So the multilinguality of it, people being able to converse, as we unfortunately cannot do today, but in their language of choice.
We are using multi-language in our outbound service we deliver. So we have made a framework of it. So a lot of branding items are in that one. And we can deliver the multi-language. I think it's important. It's the question from the client. So we should take it serious and fix this thing.
Yeah.
But does it also apply, because that's your, let's say, more traditional communication, but does it also apply to, for example, your personalized interactive video or your chatbot, or because then it becomes?
Yeah, we have discussed also about personal and relevant. I think, and when you make it multi-language, and someone is working in Germany, okay, I think it should be wonderful that it is in German, and that makes it personal and relevant.
Als je een video Duits spreken kan, hè? Marcus, this one was for you.
I come from a country, Belgium, where four languages are obliged by law. For me, multi-language has always been part of my life, and working in this fantastic space of customer interaction and customer communications, yeah, it is a challenge, but it's doable. You just need to do it. It requires a higher investment, but at the end, if we look at the economy in the world, yeah, we have a lot of refugees, people are moving. I think it's important that we, if we say we live in a global economy, I think we need, as our companies should support more languages or foresee an exit language, minimum. So yeah. Do it well or don't do it, I would say.
But knowing the you know more vendors than we do. We know a lot of vendors and we work with a lot of them. I would still say a little bit of criticism that they can still think more multilingual in the sense that, yes, we can build those videos and chats and whatnot, but often we have to do a lot of extra work to get it to work, whereas you would want a minimum of labor extra to put it in extra in order to enable more languages. So this is a call to all our suppliers and vendors to even look more into that aspect, because a lot of them are American and they often think that, what is it, the Netherlands is the capital of Denmark?
Yeah, something like
right?
that.
Right? So, and they don't know about multilinguality, but you living in Belgium, you've got German, French, Dutch, and maybe even some English spoken.
Yeah, four languages.
We've run into projects.
Sure. But look at Canada, which is also a big country where legal is very hard there. So I think it's doable. And again, it's also by adding that purpose what I talked before about your customer. Who's your customer, right? You don't know probably. Exactly. So, yeah.
I think it's a requirement for any business who wants to stay close to their customers. So even in America, we're seeing large banks creating, you know, Chinese communications for people in Vancouver, or it is Canada, but in what is it, this Spanish language. So it's a given. But from a software development perspective, I understand they choose the biggest language to start with. It's and then they sort of evolve. So
yeah. So to wrap this up, people like to be spoken to in their own language. They like it to be personalized. They like to be relevant. I should add interactive, right? Yeah. The new technology, that's what we haven't discussed a lot about yet. But the difference between traditional, let's say, analog communication and digital is that digital can be bidirectional, right?
Absolutely.
In that video, you can ask a customer for its email address if you don't have it.
Absolutely.
And if you do have it, you don't have to ask for it.
Absolutely.
You just show it.
Yeah.
But even then, you the customer should be able to press a button and say, well, this was my old email address. I want to update it right now. Yeah. So what do you say about that interactivity? Is that used enough already in use cases?
No, I mean, that's the difficult thing. It's like really hard to build interactivity across channels. That's really hard. So it requires a real clear dedication by the people building those solutions to do that. So it's because what you need to have multiple things coming together. I think that's the challenge. There's the data element, there's the content element, there's the personalization, the orchestration that sits underneath. Unfortunately, it is a complex space. And I think one of the things, and maybe this is slightly different, but based on what we're seeing in the market, that a lot of enterprises are getting to a point where they feel they need to change rapidly, to a point where they need experts outside of their organization to help them with this. So companies like you guys that have an understanding about what is best technology and what can integrate, what can work together, how can we solve those challenges? Because there's a lot of stuff coming and it's complex.
Yeah.
And they need to do it now.
And also, final remarks on that, Patrick, is that it needs to be contextual, right? If you know you're delivering a message to a mobile device, I don't need a PDF where I need to pinch and everything to find the information. I just want to know the amount of my bill. So on my device, also device independency is really crucial.
Yeah.
Just present, and the English word is beautiful, glanceable content. Just present the content you really need on your glass, right? Don't just migrate PDF and then we're digital. No, in my opinion, that's not enough. So in the right time of moment, putting in the right contextual data, and I don't need all the legal stuff, I understand it needs to be there, but then I would maybe print it or read it on paper and not on my iPad, for example, or whatever. So also contextual and device, I think that's really important.
And also understand the use cases. So we were talking to a company that was sending sort of mortgage notifications through WhatsApp, and it was really interesting because consumers, some of them that was in Latin America, they liked that.
Yeah.
But what they found was that customers were then saying after a year, "Ooh, where is that communication that I received through WhatsApp?" And then you have a problem because the channel is not meant to, as an archive, and to store that and to function as a document repository. And that's and sort of sometimes you can overdo it. So you really need to think through, okay, what is the customer really, what are their goals? What do they want to achieve? And what channel is the best one to use there?
Which is funny because we are now moving into, if people remember my first presentation, my first slide was personalized, interact, blah, blah, and it ended with two statements. It should be easy and it should be fun. And I see stuff coming here from Romé van den Ende that says it should be, it should have a specific tone of voice. But I think to elaborate on the easy part, human touch for me might also be, and I would like your opinion on it, that it shouldn't be too complicated, right? Because we're all human, we all have our flaws and we all have our attention spans. And how do you do, is it touchable by a human? Is it touched by a human, the communication that you receive? Eh? Is it built for me?
Yeah.
How do you see that?
Difficult question to answer. I think it's very complex in doing. You mentioned, Casper, a lot of ingredients for a client in order to get the personalized, relevant, digitalized information, and that's a lot of work to do for the companies.
If I understand your question correctly, Patrick, how can we use other channels to explain it maybe better? For example, I moved from Belgium to the Netherlands. Then I was faced with the pension system in the Netherlands. I get many letters. I can read Dutch, I believe. I understand Dutch, but I still don't understand it. But by pulling in a personal advisor or a video which explains it to me, then it's more relevant to me and I understand it better and I don't need to call to ask all other questions that easily could be explained by other. And if I have the question, probably other people also have. So I think that's a balance where you can also see what is my customer asking. And if you know what the customer is asking, you can do something with that data, because everybody goes insane about NPS, but I'm willing to give my rating or whatever survey, but I never get back what that companies did with that rating or with that feedback. That would be nice.
Yeah, but that's like also you say, personal. Using stuff like video where you see a human talking to you in perfectly understandable words instead of having to read a 15-page PDF full of legal terms, that'll helps enormously. I think with your aflossingsvrij, difficult to pronounce, a video, but also the one we showed last year, where people that were close to the end of a payment of their pension fund got a video with options what to do with it.
Yep.
And they were explained in layman terms how they could proceed. And what that company saw, that was Vivat, by the way, is that a lot more people reinsured the money instead of just taking it and not knowing what to do with it. So I think a human touch is the word outside in comes to mind, right?
Yeah.
Let your
co-create, cooperation.
Yeah.
And I think you can also look at all the customer journeys within the companies, and for each customer journey there should be another approach. Yeah. And so so it's more tailored instead of one fits all. You know, it should be personal, and then we come back to personal, relevant, digital. Yeah.
That's why I like customer journeys. It's not about the company, it's about the customer. Otherwise, it would be a company journey, right?
Yeah.
So that's the purpose of a customer journey. There is where you listen, Patrick, and where you collect your feedback to improve your processes. And hey, newsflash, it never stops, right? It's continuous improvement, continuous change. Sometimes I think we need to be more children again, like always asking the question, why not? Recognize that?
Yeah.
If a child asks a question to you and you can give the answer, but why? And you answer, why? And again, in the companies, we stop. We say, okay, we do it. We never ask again, why?
And you can't mitigate that by just saying, we've got four personas, so we're good, right?
Yeah.
We've got four personas, so this guy is like that. We send him these kinds of emails, and it doesn't work like that. I think And there's a heated discussion going on.
Yeah, it's very fast.
Even with people starting to use French. I can read that, Marcus. I think it's really important to be able to offer the kind of specific communications or interactions, as we call them, because communication to me is more, this is my communication, read it and weep. No, I'm interacting with you, and you can choose what to see, and you can choose what to do next. Yeah. I think that's the beauty of the digital, and that helps maybe a little bit with human touch. And as much as I like Tesla, for example, they hide themselves behind their app.
Oh, yeah.
You can't reach a person with that company, which is
insane.
Part of the human touch that I miss.
Yeah.
Right. So humans for me will always stay important. For the same reason, I will never work from home 100%. I would just become very lonely.
Personal is really important. If we just again a big shout out to all our technical people here behind the scenes, but that was also a personal bond. The guy you made the effort to come here, that's personal relationship. It's nothing to do with our business model, but just like humans are good in essence and want to help each other, I believe. So I think that's really important to emphasize.
Okay, I want to move to the last one and elaborate for 3 minutes about that. What do you guys see as best practices? And Edwin talked a little bit about that, and I believe Casper as well. On how to speed up your innovation to really drive the digital transformation that is now necessary in the COVID era, with all the problems that big companies face.
I think you saw the example. We started with our new strategic commitments, so products and services, customer and interaction is an important one. So it starts also at the top, so with your strategy and ambition. I think that's an important one, and creating. I also mentioned it earlier. Creating the right mindset with our employees, but also with the customers, and have that interaction. I think that are important drivers to become more digital and together make that digital transformation. We are not alone. We are with suppliers, with our customers, and the company itself. And just starting, waiting exactly. for all the...
Be pragmatic.
I mean, this question, it could be a whole presentation on it.
I know.
So typically, when we look at sort of, you know, IT, often we say, okay, it's a combination of technology, of people and process, right? That's sort of what we look at. So the people aspect, absolutely. Digital culture, having the right mindset, having people that have a can-do mentality, really important. And also from a process perspective, ensure that you have an innovation hub, a center of excellence, or some sort of structure that enables those people to do what they love doing, experimenting and not being hindered by all kind of bureaucracy or, you know, lots of other legal challenges. And it's a problem because when you want to scale that and put it into production, it needs sorting out. So I'm not saying it's not important. But when you're in that sort of innovation phase, I feel just be able to do that. And then the third part, the technology. We're seeing the shift to cloud, I think is important. Why? Because it helps you to connect other type of software into a similar sort of platform and ecosystem. And it enables you to start small and then to scale up using cloud infrastructure. And you don't need to, you know, think about servers and all kind of sort of hardware. It scales much quicker. And typically it's priced on an OPEX model. Subscription, you can start small, low cost, and then you can sort of expand, or you sort of can extrapolate what the expense would be. So those type of things are happening, but it's easier said than done.
Yeah, I know.
I mentioned in my presentation that some companies, particularly very large ones, say, well, maybe it's easier if you just spin off that into a dedicated company and have a sort of digital, you know, a neobank or something that is sort of new and can innovate and can do that and can use new technology to sort of start doing that.
Maybe with that we can change our focus from being internal oriented towards outside in thinking. Yeah. So that's all with the cloud movement, etc. So I agree.
Maybe a final statement from you, Philippe.
Yeah, not the final one, I think. I hope. I think, Casper said it all from a technical point of view, for business view. I think what I would like to add to the mix is a willingness and creativity. again, yeah. Being that child again, why? Yeah. Keep pushing, yeah. Start small, be fast, be agile or whatever. Just look at what's happening in the world. It's always amazing that people are very digital savvy in their personal lives. And when they go to the office or in their business, they suddenly change or something. I don't know what that is sometimes. Yeah. But yeah, just be willing. Patrick is also a great example of it. How do you say that in English? Do not think in limitations, but in possibilities. That's a whole different mindset.
Yeah.
The company I see in the Netherlands with great examples there is for example, Coolblue, right? I think that's really amazing what they're doing, the creativity, spot on, bicycle deliverments, the CEO talking with Sinterklaas. I think, yeah, that's a great example of being creative.
Yeah, so personal is also, again, that fun. And
they're not selling the product, but they're selling an experience, right?
Yeah. And they are also tweaking. Eh? So when a customer needs his human touch, he goes to the office and can see the products. But when and the other things are, okay, he needs a digital experience. It starts at the front door. Eh?
I think that's
good examples.
Okay, so I guess I really have to cut us short. I could talk to you for hours.
Yes.
But I also understand that for our viewers, it's quite tiresome to constantly watch the screen. I still want to call out to you. Thank you very much, Edwin, Kaspar, and Philippe.